It has been an eventful end to the quarter with the NBFC, HFC space going through a stress test of its business model, so to speak. Dearth of liquidity is a key risk to models that are largely wholesale funded. It is something that we have well recognized at Indiabulls Housing for over a decade, and management of liquidity has been a key operating principle for us. Our principle has been to operate with adequate liquidity to suffice 6 months of debt repayment. This is to negotiate situations exactly of this nature. And indeed, liquidity freeze occurs fairly regularly every 4 to 5 years in India. In 2008, following the global financial crisis, we had such a freeze. Then again in 2010, following the telecom auction. And then in 2013, when the Reserve Bank had to raise short-term interest rates by over 300 basis points. Through each of these crises, our policy of maintaining adequate liquidity to suffice 6 months debt repayment has seen us come out stronger, and each of these events and our resilience through them have served as a trigger for a rating upgrade in the past. When the present crisis hit on the 21st of September, we had over ₹230 billion of liquidity with us. Subsequently, in the next few days, all the rating agencies that rate us, namely CRISIL, ICRA, CARE, and Brickworks, after due diligence, reaffirmed our ratings at the highest long-term rating of AAA in the very next week. To reiterate, despite the negative carry, MTM movement, and impact on the P&L, for well over 10 years now, we have been maintaining adequate liquidity, which has been a long-standing operating principle of Indiabulls Housing business. We've spoken about this and also recently summarized this in the disclosure filed with the exchanges on 7th of September. As of September end, we have closed with cash and liquid investments of ₹212.5 billion without taking into account any undrawn lines of any nature. We continue to take pioneering industry-first initiatives. We were first to get all of our incremental LAP loans graded in 2015, an year or so prior to demonetization, and that came in really handy. We saw the changing distribution model and took the first steps through our e-home loan platform of digitizing loan origination and underwriting, which we have now further built upon a comprehensive digital home loan technology platform, and this initiative was taken in 2016. 2 years ago, we voluntarily, regulations do not require it, chose to get all of our direct assignment pools monitored on a monthly basis by CRISIL, again AMI, pioneering step. And as I mentioned in fiscal 17 results call, internally we had moved to a liquidity framework that is guided by Basel III and is in line with the liquidity ratios prescribed for banks. If you refer to slides 11 and 12, the 30-day liquidity coverage ratio is computed as the ratio of liquid investments, including investments in government securities, PSU bonds, etc., termed as high-quality liquid assets, to 30 days of net outflows. The LCR is meant to build resilience against acute liquidity stress scenarios, such as loss of unexpected wholesale funding, something that the sector is currently undergoing, or rating action or decrease in valuation of collateral, etc. The LCR of Indiabulls Housing is at over 400% and covers 30-day net outflows with a 4x cover. This, for most private banks, is adjusted for CRR and SLR, is at around 130%. Without CRR, SLR is at about 90%. Akin to banks, we've also adopted an approach of granular ALM that particularly focuses on near-term maturity of assets and liabilities. On slide 12, you will observe that we are fully matched on all ALM buckets. Through the last 2 weeks of September, we continue to borrow from the market and borrowed plus sold down loan pools totaling to ₹34.7 billion over the past 3 weeks. We've also bought back ₹18.2 billion worth of our papers from the market, thus providing liquidity to our mutual fund partners, as well as instilling confidence in them with regards to the safety of our paper. IBHFL is also the only non-bank company in India to follow a strict and conservative practice of repayments through a third-party trust managed by Axis Bank trustee, wherein all scheduled repayments are transferred to the trust 7 days in advance on a rolling basis, thereby ensuring timely, fail-proof repayment discipline of all obligations. A testament to our debt subscribers' confidence to us is the fact that ₹5.8 billion worth of IBHFL's paper were traded in the secondary market over the past 3 weeks, which otherwise seems to have been quite locked up. Thus, all three parts which are vital to a liability franchise are working. We are being able to additionally borrow. There is secondary activity in our paper. And in order to make sure that our papers are properly and confidently held, we also continue to buy back from time to time. Besides liquidity, the other area of key focus for the company has been management of capital. And traditionally, we have maintained the highest levels in the industry of capital adequacy. Our capital adequacy stands at 23.39%, which is the highest amongst our large HFC peers. Our net gearing of 5.9x is one of the best and the lowest in the industry. Additionally, our NPA levels have continued to remain very moderate, with a gross NPA at 0.77 and net NPA at 0.58. With all the provisions that we carry for stage 1 and 2, stage 3, as well as the ad hoc provisions that we had been able to create last quarter, our provisions to gross NPA stand at 168%. Our gross NPAs have now remained below 0.9% for 29 quarters. With our micros on a strong footing, I believe an improving macro condition through appropriate regulatory and government actions is necessary to regain the investor confidence in this industry. The RBI in its bi-monthly monetary policy meet on October 5th held the repo rates unchanged at 6.5%, which is positive for the entire NBFC sector. This would also hopefully bring down bond yields, as was seen by the 13 basis points decline in the 10-year G-Sec yields on the day of RBI's announcement. In addition to this, the RBI has also taken a string of measures to increase liquidity in the system to further bring down bond yields. They've injected ₹200 billion into the system through open market operations in September and have announced open market operations to the tune of further ₹360 billion in October. RBI has also notified that banks could carve up to 15% of their holdings under the SLR against 13% allowed previously to meet the liquidity coverage ratio requirements, which is likely to infuse around ₹2.5 trillion into the banking system in quarter three. Open market operations along with LCR carve-out may likely ease pressures of yields going forward. On October 9th, the National Housing Bank, our regulator, also increased the refinance limit for housing finance companies for fiscal 19 to $300 billion from the original budget of $240 billion. Just for clarity, before I move on, I must also comment that for everyone's understanding that ILNFS, which is in some ways seem to have caused this entire crisis, is not a classic NBFC that extends loans to end retail customers, small businesses and corporates. It is largely a core investment company which borrows money for lending to its own group companies or co-investing with them. These group companies are mainly in the business of infrastructure development and management of the same. Its lending portfolio to third parties is only about ₹134 billion, which is about 10% of its balance sheet size and an insignificant 0.6% of the total NBFC HFC loan industry loan book. Thus, the fear of ILNFS kind of business risks in other NBFCs, HFCs is largely misplaced. A brief overview of the major HFCs and NBFCs would prove that the business fundamentals of these companies, along with their growth potential, asset quality and capitalization, are on a solid footing. Rating agencies have also said that NBFCs and HFCs have been maintaining adequate liquidity buffer for any mismatches in their ALM. There is no real concern on the liquidity of HFCs and NBFCs or their solvency. In effect, the ongoing crisis is not actually a liquidity crisis, but a crisis of confidence amongst market participants. Now, coming to the numbers for the quarter, I am very pleased to announce that the board has approved an interim dividend of Rs. 10 per share. Dividends are keeping in pace with our guidance of paying 50% of profits as dividends. This is the second quarter where we published our results under Ind AS. Now, please refer to slide 6 of the earnings update. Our growth story continues. Our balance sheet at the end of quarter 2 fiscal 19 stood at 1.4 trillion, up 20.4%. Our AUM has grown almost 29% to 1.29 trillion. Capital adequacy is just under 24% against a regulatory requirement of 12%. Our borrowing stand at 1.2 trillion and the net of cash and liquid investments of 188.72 billion. Our net gearing stands at 5.9x. Our book value per share now stands at Rs. 410. Our profits after tax for the quarter are at Rs. 10.44 billion, up 21.2% from 8.61 billion in quarter 2 fiscal 18, and our 20.99 billion for first half of fiscal 19, despite all the adverse bond movements and the resultant mark to market. With the adverse movement in bond yields, we took an MTM loss. Consequently, the NII for the quarter stood at Rs. 16.31 billion, up 17.4%, up from 13.89 billion. For the first half, NII grew by 20% to 33.2 billion from 27.6 billion in the first half last year. Please now turn to slide 9 of the earnings update. Total provisions at the end of quarter 2 fiscal 19 stood at 16.67 billion. As you are all aware, in ECL model, we classify our assets under stage 1, 2, and 3, with stage 3 assets being equivalent to NPA under the older regulations. Our stage 3 assets and hence gross NPA are at 0.77%, while the remaining 99.23% assets are in stage 1 and 2. We have created Rs. 3.7 billion of ECL provisions against stage 1 and 2 assets. The experiential loss given default in stage 3 is 25%, and hence we have provisions of Rs. 2.5 billion against stage 3 assets. In addition to this, Rs. 6.2 billion, we have Rs. 10.5 billion of ad hoc provisions that we had retained during quarter 1 fiscal 19 from our erstwhile provisions under the Indian GAAP regime. As communicated during the last quarter's call, we will maintain ad hoc provisions at this level going forward. This is in line with our ultra-conservative approach towards provisioning. There have also been concerns that tightening liquidity will spill over to the SME and the real estate developer sector, making refinancing difficult, ultimately impacting asset quality. Our underwriting approach to LAP has been discussed often, and it continues to be cash flow-based, where applicants' SME's business is evaluated to a certain long-term loan repayment ability. The LAP grading done by CRISIL and ICRA, which is reflected in the earning update for over 3 years now, relies mainly on analysis of loan applicants' financials. You will note that over 99% of the LAP we have sourced since April 2015 is in the top 3 grade of the 5-point scale. As mentioned earlier, voluntarily we also get all of our sold down pools monitored on monthly basis. On slide 44, we've shown that since LAP underwriting is cash flow based, and this is a very interesting table that we have put up. On slide 44, we've shown that since LAP underwriting is cash flow based, the loan repayments are immune to fluctuation in residential price inflation. At the bottom left, we've shown that since the LTVs at dispersal are moderate, at about 50%, even an extreme 30% price fall over a period of time still leaves us with a 2x cover. At the bottom right, and this is extremely important in the current context, we presented experiential data that shows that 80% of prepayment is either regular repayment or accelerated prepayment. Full prepayment, which could be either coming from own sources or possible refinancing, forms only about 20% of repayments that we see in LAP. Please now refer to slide 32. Similarly, for our corporate mortgage portfolio, does not rely on refinancing. If you review slide 32, you will realize that over 70% of the corporate loan book is supported by lease rent discounting. We rely heavily on the concept of cross-collateralization whenever we do construction finance. The core of the book continues to be lease rent discounting. Lease rent discounting are loans to developers against their leased out commercial buildings, which are office space buildings. We look for moderate rentals between 35 to 85 per square foot per month. The average rental for the LRD portfolio of Indiabulls is at 56 rupees per square foot. Our approach to credit in LRD is as follows. We look for multi-tenanted buildings so that there is no tenant concentration. A rent to EMI cover of over 1.2 times. Low average LTV of about 45%. The lease in our LRD buildings are typically marquee international names, MNCs and top Indian companies. We also do not factor in rent escalation. As a result, some of the most marquee private equity deals that you've heard of in India with the larger real estate developers have been around assets which have been financed and were originally mortgaged to Indiabulls Housing, including perhaps the top three private equity transactions which have happened in the country. At moderate rentals of rupees 56 per square foot per month, when you consider that a tenant typically spends about rupees 2,500 to do up the interiors, the tenant has sunk in over 40 months of rent. The risk of vacancy thus gets significantly diminished. In our LRDs, we have an escrow mechanism under an irrevocable structure by which tenants deposit rent into a central escrow account from which monies first go towards loan repayment servicing. Thus, to the utmost extent possible, our LRD loans are truly bankruptcy remote from the circumstances of the borrowing developer. Similarly, to speak a little bit about residential construction finance, as mentioned earlier, over 70% of the overall book is supported by LRD facilities, and most of the construction finance that we do would be generally cross-collateralized with another LRD facility. The encumbrance-free land comes to us upfront, which is the project land, comes to us as an upfront equity. We deal with the top 5 to 7 developers and insist on land coming in upfront and being at least 50% of the overall project value. If the underlying project land for some reason is of lower value, we take additional parcels of land to ensure that at least 50% is coming to us as upfront equity. We fund only once all project permissions have been received and there is full financial closure at sanction, such that net cash flows from pre-sales cover loan amount at least one time. Total net cash flows, including net future receivables from unsold areas, cover the loan 3 to 4 times. The disbursements are all construction linked. The projects that we fund are targeted at the upper middle class clientele in the top 6 cities of the country. Now, going back to the more operating data around this quarter, our disbursals for the quarter stood at 110.34 billion rupees. The disbursals break up into 61.16 for home loans, 18.69 for LAP, and 30.49 for corporate mortgage loans. Our home loan book now forms over 60% of our loan portfolio, with LAP and CC accounting for 39%. LAP being 19 and commercial corporate book being 20%. We are on track to reach our target of achieving 66% of home loans by 2020. If you now refer to slide 64 of the earnings update, our spreads on the stock of loans now stands at 324 basis points and is at the higher end of our guided range of 300 to 325 basis points. We continue to convert our fixed rate bonds to floating rate through interest rate swaps and in the process save around 90 basis points in the short term. We are thus an efficient pass-through vehicle and our spreads have held within the guided range through rate cycles as shown at the bottom left of the slide. Additionally, we have also sold down loans worth 46.6 billion in the first half of fiscal 19. This continues with the active securitization program that we follow. With liquidity expected to be tight, portfolio securitization would play a very important role in raising incremental funds. PSU banks, who are the main investors in portfolio sell downs, have increased their loan borrowing targets for the year. We aim to sell down close to about rupees 8 billion in the second half. For first half, we also raised ECBs, and between ECBs and portfolio sell downs, both contributed to almost 40% of our incremental borrowings. We have a similar ambitious plan for ECBs in the second half also. Blended for all, our cost of funds on book basis stood at 8.12% and on incremental basis at 8.08%. Our incremental spread for the quarter came in at 280 bips, well within our guided range of 275 to 300 bips. I consider the current volatile times to be an opportunity for Indiabulls Housing. We look forward to continuously evolving regulations as an evolved regulatory framework will provide stable operating environment over the medium to long term. In the short term, it may well protect all of us, companies and stakeholders from rumor mongering as well. To sum up, while in the short term, the focus is on liquidity management, the fact is that this crisis will squeeze out some of our competitors, thus making the competitive landscape even more benign. Fortunately, our largest area of focus, which is mid-income housing, the home sales have picked up with strong growth in both sales and new launches. And given the micro strength and the strength on the asset side, we are extremely confident of sustaining our growth at over 20% levels. Thank you so much, and we will now take questions. Before we get into questions, we will have to keep this call slightly brief this time. The company is also organized later today an event with CRISIL, our rating agency, where CRISIL is making a presentation on the credit profile of the company. And Mr. Mundra, the former deputy governor who retired last year and who's just come on board as an independent director of Indiabulls Housing, is making a keynote address, which will be followed by a panel discussion on the bond markets. And on the panel, we have Mr. Agarwal of Reliance Industries, Mr. Sabarwal of Tata Capital, Mr. Raj Kiran Rai, the MD of Union Bank of India, Mr. Bala Subramaniam, the CEO of Birla, and Mr. Prasoon, the CIO of HDFC Life. So the management will have to head out there shortly. We'll take maybe five questions and then we will have to address this. We are happy to take questions one-on-one as well.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the attached tone phone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Anisha Khandelwal from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Kunal over here. So, firstly, given this kind of entire liquidity situation, so what's our stance overall in terms of the growth, and maybe with respect to the commercial papers, so if we can just get the further breakup on the borrowing side, on the debt, between like how much is the commercial papers and how much is bond and debentures, and maybe if we can get the breakup on the liability in terms of the subscribers as well, so in terms of how much is from mutual funds, how much is from banks, and all put together.
Okay, so as far as growth is concerned, you know, while, as I mentioned earlier, I think with our liquidity management, our credit ratings, as well as our capital structure, I continue to be optimistic that we should be able to grow by about 20%. That said, you know, we have to see the market going back to its normal functioning. And I think market will take its a little bit of time, so we will have to remain mindful. At this point in time, unlike some of our peers, we are not in a mad race of raising liquidity. So against others who are perhaps just raising liquidity, we are managing liquidity. And that liquidity, so the principle that we are following is that we have give or take 20,000-21,000 crores of cash. We are ensuring that that number does not get depleted, especially for growth of our loan book. So if we are getting new monies which are over and above whatever are our loan obligations, we will continue to grow our book. Otherwise, the management will remain focused on management of liquidity. Fortunately, we are getting new monies. As mentioned, we have raised around 3,500 crores in the last two and a half weeks. And we are also engaged with several counterparties to raise both long-term bonds as well as loans through securitization, etc. So I'm very confident that we will continue to get growth capital. But till that time, we will continue to, till the time that the money actually does not hit the bank and we see our liquidity going up, we will continue to focus on that single-mindedly. So that should answer the question. So in short term, it is about liquidity management. Over the medium term, we are confident that we will continue to grow 20%. Our CPs would be approximately, for Indiabulls Housing, it will be in the ballpark of 15,000 crores on an overall borrowing of approximately 1.2 lakh crore. And about 30% of our borrowings come from mutual funds, and the balance comes from banks, insurance companies, provident funds, and international FIIs, etc.
So with respect to this CPs of 15,000 crores, how would it be? So maybe in terms of the rollover when it comes in, so will this get substituted with other forms of borrowing, and obviously maybe the CP as a proportion of the balance sheet would come off quite significantly going forward, at least in the near term over next 6 to 9 odd months?
CP would willy-nilly come down, I guess, over a period of time. By how much, it's very difficult for me to say by how much it would come. From whatever I gather, apart from some shrinkage of liquid fund schemes of mutual funds, etc., I don't expect a big rollover challenge. But that said, I think, there are proposals which we have made to the National Housing Bank to allow for short-term borrowings of housing finance companies to be substituted by secured bonds of a shorter-term nature as against commercial paper. So all of this said, I think directionally, yes, CPs will be a little lower to where they are on percentage basis. And other longer-term funding sources will probably continue to increase as a percentage of our borrowing.
And lastly, in terms of spreads on incremental loans, so we have been giving out the guidance, but now in this liquidity scenario, how have we looked at it in terms of, like, say, last week of September or maybe October till date? How is the movement in this spreads on incremental loans?
So in a matter of 2 weeks or a month, it generally so last week of September, I think the market itself did not know where it wanted to price any kind of credit. Now, if you think of some CP that we've rolled over late last week, then we I think rolled it over at 770-775. Bank 775, if I'm not mistaken. If I think of banks in the meantime have increased MCLRs by anywhere between 5 to 20 basis points. And the bonds that we last placed were at about 9.5 annualized, which works to 9.1 monthly, which works to about 8.5 or so on a floating basis. So these are the yields. So it is, I'm not particularly concerned about where yields are. I think as a AAA, it's more a question, as I said during my comments, that it's more a question of confidence than liquidity. If someone is confident of continuing to be a participant on the other side, the pricing would be more or less logical. In the meantime, in April, we've already increased our home loan rates by 20 basis points or so. So the transmission process is going on. Since April, home loan rates are up 70 basis points. And so that transmission is not unique to Indiabulls. The entire industry has done a transmission of 70 basis points. So I would, you know, break up the current situation in three parts. There is the next 60 days where one will have to be mindful of management of liquidity. One has done it in the past through 2008, 10, 13, etc. Today, I'm reasonably confident that most mutual funds who have to roll over our paper over the next 30 days actually have more money kept with them than the paper that they have to roll over. So that should give them a lot of confidence. So with that strength and the strength of a very strong capital base and strong provisions, over the next 60 days, I think Indiabulls Housing has to solely focus on liquidity management. After that, we will get growth capital. I don't see a major disruption in growth capital cost, and therefore I don't see any major disruption in margins. In the interim, we continue to be a pass-through vehicle, which we have demonstrated in the past. So the problem is not as complicated that all aspects of business are under any kind of a challenge. I would rather imagine that, you know, as the competitive landscape becomes more benign, the pricing power actually goes up over the next few months.
Oh, okay. Thanks a lot for all the clarification. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Saurabh Kumar from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
I have two questions. One on slide 44. So you said your LAP repayments are typically about 20% in a year. What is typically the repayment in your mortgage book and CC book in a year?
So mortgage would be about 1.3 to 1.5% monthly, which works out to about 15 to 17% annualized. And CC would be about almost 25 and 30% annualized.
This excludes the LRD, right?
No, including the LRD, because the LRD is also prone to frequent refinance. So including LRD, the average would be between 25 and 30%.
Okay. And on slide 32, you have kind of mentioned some standards of your CC lending.
Yes.
I just want to check the pre-sales, the cash cover you've calculated, pre-sales plus loan inflow, less construction cost. This
yeah.
is based on what is already sold, not unsold
yeah.
inventory, right?
No, this is what is already sold. On unsold, which is the total, if you come to bullet number 5, average cash flow covered computed taking into account unsold units would be between 3 and 4 times.
Okay, so basically just based on sold, you can repay the loan at least.
Yeah.
I mean, okay. All right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ritesh Nambiar from UTI Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. So I wanted a little more clarity on this liquid investment of yours. So the 17,000 number, so how is the breakup like? How much is in mutual funds? How much is in proper GSEC? And broadly wanted to know if what is the time horizon, because in mutual funds you can get your money in a day or two, but in other investments, how much time would it take for you to liquidate on a worst case scenario?
So the if you refer to slide 11,
right.
So this 17,000 crores, a bulk of it would be with mutual funds. And you know, government securities, etc. Also, generally speaking, you will not wait for maturity. You would wait for a secondary market opportunity. I don't think India yet has a secondary market lockup in which you cannot sell government securities. So this is basis, you know, whatever are the prescribed guidelines of HQLA, and therefore this money is all available for liquidation within 7 days.
Okay, and how much you said, how much is in mutual funds, a figure?
The mutual funds will be about 11,000 crores.
Okay. Secondly, just wanted to have a sense, and there was a press release that, in fact, your rates have got reset in home loans by 20 basis and in LAP as high as 200 basis. So is it true, and what's the strategy like more so in LAP?
So the rate reset is 20 basis points for home loans, retail LAP by 100 basis points, and larger LAP and corporate, so all the corporate mortgage loans between 100 and 200 basis points. So the clear strategy is that, one, we stay pretty much in line with the market. So I think most market participants on corporate loans have increased rates between 100 to 200 basis points, either by changing benchmarks or by increasing spreads. Both strategies have been resorted. Rather than increasing spreads, we have increased the benchmark for the large loans. And clearly, one is spread management, and the other is that in the larger loan portfolio, if there is some refinance because of this, we will welcome that liquidity also.
One more clarity I wanted, because you had this 30-day liquidity, but mutual funds are more redemptions are in November and some in December. So how is this 90-day liquidity or a 60-day liquidity looking like, which is 401, which you're seeing on a 30-day window?
What's November and December?
Generally, CPs, most of the CPs are maturing on November till December. So how is this ratio looking like if you extend it to a 60-day net?
So that's, you have to refer to slide 12.
Okay.
We are 135% cover on our six-month liability outflow. And if you look at up to 90 days, so we will have 1.6 time cover.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Adarsh Parasrampuria from Nomura. Please go ahead. Adarsh, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with your questions. As there is no response, we move to the next question from the line of Agastya Dave from CAO Capital. Please go ahead.
Hey, thank you very much for the opportunity. And also, I appreciate the level of depth that you have gone through in the presentation. It's very, very useful. So I wanted to ask you, what about the worst-case scenario if it plays out, right? Which is that, as of now, as you said, it's more a problem of confidence rather than liquidity. My previous interactions with you guys have led me to believe that liquidity for you guys, right, the way you manage your ALM. So let's just assume that there is actually a stress in some pockets, right, because for some of the HFCs and some of the NBFCs, some of the loans will become illiquid, right? The assets which are backing the loans will become illiquid. So will we see losses going up, loan losses going up? There will be some repercussions, right? If not for you, then for others. And hence, will there be a chain effect on your assets also? For example, you have mentioned that your expected LGD is around 25%. Do you expect that number to change if the worst case scenario plays out?
So if we refer to slide 44, then I go back to the point I was trying to make in my comments. So generally speaking, loan losses for a specific company would go down basis in the short term if, we were doing asset-based kind of financing. And and if refinance market would freeze up because some NBFCs and HFCs don't have money, therefore you know, we would get stuck. But as this data shows, the top data shows that, you know, despite real estate pricing, prices moving up and down, and refinance is really an outcome of how real estate prices are moving. If you have lent $100 today on a property worth $200, you know, you can probably lend $120, $130, but no one would lend $160 on a property of $200. At some point in time, that market stops and refinance, therefore, as a consequence, stops. If you look at real estate prices in India ever since 2014, there has hardly been any inflation. So, you know, 3%, 7%, 5%. So assets haven't really been, prices haven't really been growing. But the repayment rate hasn't come down. And it hasn't come down because cash flows of our borrowers have continued to be steady. So if you look at the bottom right table, then that indicates that bulk of the repayment that we receive is actually the regular contracted repayment, or the borrower stays with us. And instead of giving us back $10 of EMI in a year, he lands up giving us $12 or $15 of EMI while the loan stays with us. It's only in about a fifth of our total repayments in LAP that we actually resort to getting payments eventually come back to us because of refinance. Similarly, similarly on the commercial book, a bulk of the monies that we get in are linked to rents, and those rents are not really an outcome of whether monies are available with NBFCs and HFCs or not. Those rents are coming and hitting into an escrow account, and that is really operating businesses, large companies who hire out space at about $1 a square foot, putting in rent into the escrow account. Now, if India is going to lease 43 million square feet or 45 million square feet this year in 2018, obviously the leasing market is strong. And if the leasing market is strong, I don't see any credit event happening around rent discounting. Similarly, if you look at the construction finance space, you know, home sales seem to be going up. Even today's newspapers carry the same details. So if home sales are improving for now almost a year and a half, 2 years, there is the Real Estate Regulation Act also in play, which puts fairly onerous liability on all these developers. Why will these buildings not come up and get sold? So for some of our peers who may have done asset-based lending, some of the fears that you mentioned could be relevant. I am reasonably confident that this is not, at least in the short term, going to play into a credit contagion. It is a crisis of confidence. And crisis of confidence, the industry, if it shows resilience for the next month or so, I am reasonably confident that this crisis of confidence will go away.
Gagan, just a couple of final questions from my side. One, can you give us a little bit of commentary on the RERA part? From what I understand, there were some states which are facing problems, and a lot of, for example, in Karnataka, a lot of projects are stuck. So, what are you seeing on the ground? And also a bit of commentary, you obviously are trying to focus on home loans and trying to focus on the affordable side and the reasonably priced properties. But what about the luxury side? So how big is our exposure on our current balance sheet? There is a lot of, I guess, a lot of problem in the Bombay real estate and the NCR region. And it's a small part as such. There is a volume-wise, there is a much bigger market out there. But value-wise, this is a big chunk of the market, right? So are you seeing anything, any commentary on that part would be pretty useful?
Yeah, so, you know, so take the case of Central Bombay, which some of you will be familiar with. You know, the large exposures there are well understood that they are not with us and that they are with some other peers. So that's really not the nature of the lending that we have usually done. So we have been looking at financing properties in the residential construction finance space, which would be priced at between 4 and 10,000 rupees a square foot. In the case of Bombay, that could go up to maybe 12,000 to 12,500 rupees a square foot. It wouldn't be much lower in Bombay than maybe 8,000 rupees a square foot. So we would not go to distant suburbs. We would be in suburbs. In the NCR, we would be there. And in the 6-7 markets that we focus on, we actually find that RERA is kicking and solid in each of these 6-7 markets. So it's also about, you know, state administration. So I do know that RERA works extremely well in Mumbai, and the authorities are extremely responsible. Now, whether they are being able to extend the same responsibility in Aurangabad or no, I do not have any clue, but because I have no exposure in Aurangabad. In the top 6-7 cities, the customer is also extremely vocal. So if any government agency is not doing its job, you and I would both know about it on social media. So in that background, I think RERA is doing a good job. As I drive around the city, I see myself a lot of projects which had been stuck for years are now getting closer to completion. Work is happening because there are third-party liabilities which had been created, which now the developer realizes have to be delivered on. So RERA has actually done quite a fair job in de-risking the market.
Thank you very much. Good luck for the quarter. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Adarsh Parasrampuria from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Hi, Gagan. Question on the asset side. You know, NBFCs, HFCs have become, you know, fairly systemically important. In that sense, you also mentioned that, you know, some of the loans are lending linked, you know, on the commercial real estate side could, you know, may not be as secured for peers as is it for y'all. In that context, I just want to check from the regulatory perspective, do you see extra vigilance? By vigilance, what I mean is, you know, banks have been through extra vigilance on the asset side for the last 2 to 3 years from the regulator. So what's your view around that in terms of discussions with the regulator?
So I am not trying to pass any sort of a negative commentary on anyone. All I am saying is that I am extremely aware of the business model that Indiabulls Housing follows. And for years now, we have been talking about it being more cash flow based. There have been questions around at times, you know, why don't you guys grow faster? You know, why are you not entering a space where yields are slightly higher? Given the fact that, you know, security is there, why are you carrying so much of cash? And I think all of those practices are from time to time come out as prudent practices to follow. And this is one such time. Now, as far as regulators are concerned, you know, unlike the Reserve Bank of India, National Housing Bank monitors the housing sector and housing finance companies. If it monitors the top 6 housing finance companies, I think it is able to cover over 80% of the assets that are in the entire HFC space. So obviously the top 6 are extremely tightly monitored, and all of us go through annual financial inspections of 4 to 6 weeks. Ours just got over, I think, 10 days ago or so. So, and it's an annual process. It happens at least once. Sometimes it happens twice a year. And, you know, the regulator, unlike a bank where it has to also look at what our branch is doing, what's going on the liability side with depositors and so on, in the case of housing finance companies, it has to only cover assets. And within assets, its larger focus is on the relatively bigger ticket loans rather than the 20-25 lakh rupee home loans. So a reasonable scrub is done with good depth. So I think how the regulatory framework will evolve is in a continuation of how it has been anyways progressing. So what might have missed people's attention is that, you know, the apparent regulatory arbitrage has been shutting over a period of time. So, you know, from a time where capital adequacy was lower, it has been increased. Standard asset provisioning came in. NPL recognition for housing finance companies was always at 90 days past due, but it went down from 180 to 90 days past due over 3 years for NBFCs. There are some ALM principles which obviously need to be tightened. They would probably get tightened, but is it going to be resulting in some sort of a massive knee-jerk where the regulator, be it RBI or NHB, would come down? I doubt that. I have not seen regulators in India, at least, behave in a knee-jerk manner. I don't think it's going to happen this time as well. Regulation, and I've also shared this with a lot of stakeholders in the past, Indiabulls is a child of regulation, and we are where we are today in terms of the size and everything, largely because of a rapidly evolving regulatory environment. Even now, if the regulation tightens up, I think it will be extremely good for the sector, medium to long term. The one thing that I worry about most is this most irresponsible rumor mongering which goes on without people referring to facts. That will probably go away if the sector is even more tightly regulated. So I most welcome regulation. That said, I'm quite confident that there would be nothing knee-jerk.
And second question, Gagan, is on what are you hearing from banks, in terms of funding you, peers, in general, if you make a, comment, both in terms of lending directly to an NBFC, HFC, or buying out portfolios, right? We've heard the SBI commentary, but I think what you want to check is more on the direct lending to the NBFC and HFC space. What's the general interactions for you and for maybe for the sector as well?
So I think NBFCs, which are able to demonstrate that they're managing their ALM well, and given the noise around this, each of us will have to demonstrate our ALM. For those who are managing their ALM well, are well capitalized, why would banks or any other lender not lend to them? At the end of the day, we are all in the business of either investing or lending, and we have to carry on. So that is the way I think the scrub would happen between ALM and capital. Generally speaking, decisions would get taken. Where we have a little bit of an extra edge over several others is that over years we have sold our portfolios to over 20 banks. So not only do banks have a good color of ALM, and now with today's move of having in a very external manner, moving on to a Basel III compliant liquidity framework, we've obviously raised the bar, and a bank will fully relate to the slides that we have put up. The bank has an additional comfort that over years we have sold, I think, about 50,000 crores of loan assets to various banks. The banks have seen those, and year on year our portfolio purchase program has only gotten stronger. So from 5,000 crores in 2017 to 10,000-11,000 crores last year, to again headed to about 14,000 crores or so this year. So there is a lot of very granular information which is available with banks. If you look at slide number 45 on the earning update, very few organizations in the country would be able to publish this type of a static analysis of their LAP portfolio. And a large part of this LAP portfolio is also lying with banks which they've acquired. Similarly, if you move on to looking at slide number 59, that has a summary of all the pools that we have sold down, and there are at least 10 sheets in here which talk about various pools that we've sold down to various banks. So all of that gives an additional comfort to a bank. They've seen us at a balance sheet level. They've seen us at a file level. And therefore, if the portfolio is performing, why will they not lend? And that in some ways is also the basis of what my interactions have been with banks.
Thanks, Evan. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Anita Ranjan from HSBC Asset Management. Please go ahead.
And I'm sorry, this will have to be the last question. Yeah.
Hi. Thanks for taking my question. I have two separate questions here. One is on the growth side. When I compare your growth from March to September, the balance sheet growth has been just around 5%. So my first question is, what gives you confidence to say that, you know, you will have a overall 20% growth? And my second question is, can you give us what would be your available bank lines as of today? Like, sanctioned limits which you have not factored in your liquidity?
Yeah, so our balance sheet, our stated objective now for quite a few years has been that the balance sheet will grow at a pace which will be slower to the loan book growth. The loan book September 17 to September 18 has grown by about 29%. The balance sheet, because of the securitization that we are doing, makes us a capital efficient structure. It also provides us with the most matched liability, since the securitization is coterminous to the loan and therefore is the most efficient way of borrowing. So please, given a loan book growth of around 29%, I am reasonably confident of our numbers. In terms of bank lines, generally speaking, the bank lines that we would be carrying would be in the range of 4,000 to 5,000 crores. And as we speak, we would have a similar number of around 5,000 crores. And on top of that, there would be securitization sanctions that we would be carrying, which would be over and above this. So from a near-term liquidity perspective, one is not concerned because of all of these buffers. And in our buffers, we haven't really referred to any of these undrawn bank lines.
Okay. What's the average kind of securitization do you do per quarter? Can you give us some sense there?
Last year, we did about 10,000 crores. In the first half, we've done just under 5,000 crores. In the second half, we should do about 8,000 crores.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. And for those of you who we may have accidentally missed out on inviting, this event is at 6:30. So it's at St. Regis. So if you can make it, we will be delighted. And thank you again for supporting Indiabulls Housing. As I said, you know, we are confident of being able to manage this situation extremely well, come out much stronger as we have through earlier periods of crisis in 2008, 10, and 13. And we should continue to follow the growth path that we have been doing over the last decade, even as these three events unfolded over the last decade. So this is just another fourth, and I'm sure there will be a fifth and a sixth, and we will be there stronger and larger than where we are today. Thank you.